to know if you can hear me. Can everybody hear me?
Wow.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
All right.
So the point of this event is really not for me to say very much other than to answer questions. It's really not primarily about me or even my platform. The point of this event is for you to get your questions answered. I have to tell you, though, a little bit about myself, because the reality is the vast majority of you never heard. So let me tell you a little bit about myself, and then we'll go ahead and question it and explain what it is appropriate for me to answer and what it is not appropriate for me to answer. Because being a candidate for district attorney is not the same thing as actually being a district attorney. So what about me? Okay, so let's keep it quick. Strange as it may seem, I grew up kind of broke and went to college, went to law school, and somewhere in between ended up a juror on a death penalty case. I would be a juror on a death penalty case, which was a very high publicity and frankly horrifying case in the sense that it involved rape and murder of an elderly woman whose house was burned down on top of her. But my experiences as a juror on that case were very instructive and are a big part of the reason I ended up going to law school and decided I would dedicate my career to criminal justice. I came out of law school and the first thing I did in my capacity as a law student looking for a summer job was I spent a summer working for indigenous rights. I spent a period of time during law school working for the Coalition for the Homeless in New York, semester, which was an organization that was successful in establishing under the New York Constitution a constitutional right to housing. I worked for the Public Defender's Office in Minneapolis. I also received a job offer for the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Eastern District of Pennsylvania while I was in law school. Came out of law school, interviewed with prosecutor's offices and public defender's offices all over the country, and to make a long story short, ended up working for the Philadelphia Public Defender's Office, both in the county and federally, was at the time the highest regarded, most awarded public defender's office in the country. And it was also a stark alternative to the district attorney's office, which was at that time, and frankly ever since, in love with the death penalty and in love with a lot of practices that have gotten us exactly where we are, which is in a pretty terrible state in terms of the criminal justice system. During my career as a lawyer, as I mentioned, I was a public defender for 5 years in different ways. Then I set out to be a civil rights lawyer, which I have been for 25 subsequent years, and I have also defended individuals charged with crimes in criminal court for those 25 years. That means I've actually been in court 4 to 5 days a week for 30 years, 25 of them as both civil rights and criminal defense lawyer. In my capacity as a civil rights lawyer, I have been known for defending free speech, nonviolent direct action, protesters, ACT UP, Occupy, Black Lives Matter, bunch of clergy, some of them here. I won't tell you who. Heeding God's Call, which was a group of clergy fighting against gun violence and doing so by trying to get gun shops to sign pretty basic promises not to engage in practices that resulted in dead people. Needless to say, they were prosecuted by the district attorney's office rather than the gun shop being prosecuted, because that's how it has worked in the city for quite some time. So that has been my career. It has involved lawsuits against the government or against law enforcement on over 75 occasions, not because I think they should always be sued, just because I think that the law should apply to police when they violate the law. And the fact is that this district attorney's office has not felt that way, and this U.S. attorney's office has been pretty effective, despite making some efforts. So, you know, I mean, I guess the best way maybe to sum it all up is I just hate bullies. I hate bullies when they're on the street corner robbing grandma, and I hate bullies when they're beating little kids, and I hate bullies when they happen to have uniforms, because I think if you wear... There are a lot of military in my family. My wife's side, actually, my father's career military, career pilot. I have a very large number of family members who actually served in the Second World War. One man were injured, some of them were killed. And frankly, she and I to behave appropriately and fairly towards everyone. It is in no way a license to break the law. And there shouldn't. There's no license for everybody else. There shouldn't be a license for people who are here.
Absolutely.
That's how I feel at that point. Now, having talked about myself for a while, which politicians tend to do, why don't we talk about what you would like to talk about? But let me say this. I want you to all understand this. It's rather important, and perhaps this has already been explained. I don't know. I was outside of this room for good reason. It's very important to understand that a candidate for district attorney cannot make you a promise about a particular case, nor should he or she even try to do so. So I've asked the organizers of this event, whenever there are questions, please do not use real names. If the questions are very, very specific about circumstances of the case, please do not use them, because when I am elected district attorney, and I have to make decisions on the cases of potentially 300 juvenile lifers, those decisions need to be made fairly. I need to come correct just like everybody else. There can't be any advance promises made about anything, and there won't. And to the extent that I'm in a position of knowing specific information about a particular case, that is not good for me, and it's not good for anyone else, because it might result in my disqualification from such a case. So with that, thank you for your patience for listening to that, finger-wagging rule. I'm happy to address your concerns.
Yes, so again, this goes back again to what Gavin was saying about strategy. So we have to be strategic, always, obviously, when dealing with electoral politics, and then with dealing with the law, which is another layer, is we definitely cannot have any of you ask any personal questions about your personal cases with your personal family members and their personal names, because we are trying to elect someone. And in that process, we cannot have any biases or anything of that sort. So everyone understands that? Okay, good. So the other thing we want to say just quickly is that there are a lot of family members here of incarcerated individuals, and we're going to try to field your questions as much as possible. The other thing is that we are open here to whatever conversations that you want to have, because we also understand that a lot of these conversations intersect and overlap. Okay, and there are a lot of issues that I have personally that I will talk with Larry about in front of you, but also behind closed doors, that his office to be will be in control of, you know. And so also, just don't think about a death by incarceration. Think about all of the issues that are tied to it also. You know, think about police brutality, which you talk about, you know, and all of these other different issues that you can ask him now. You can put him on the spot right now and say, hey, can we have your policy view on these issues? So, without further ado, yes, and so every third question we're going to have come from the inside, from one of our cabinet members. Okay, and so, we would like to open the question floor up for Mr. Krasner. Anyone?
I'm finding so many different mentality, it seems hard, it seems challenging. I don't say hard because the only thing hard is the concrete that you walk on. Everything else is a challenge. So I'm ready for this challenge, and I was built for this. I think that we all have a purpose in life, and mine